morning.
Good morning.
Welcome this morning, not many of us, but nice to have you all with us. Your notice sheet is exactly as printed. Please read that. Members for prayer this week, Astrid, who's there. Matthew and Gemma, who... Oh, they are coming. They are here. Matthew and Gemma are on our prayer list for this week, so please come there. You'll see that the ladies' evening group, which was originally planned for this Wednesday, has been cancelled. Please bear that in mind, ladies. Please also remember that we're having an induction service for Cole on the 12th of March at 2 o'clock. So please make sure that goes in your diaries now. So plenty of time to stick that in your diaries. Please make sure you remember that. That's on the 12th of March. Also, you'll see on the back of your sheet, and please remember that there are sometimes notices on the back of your sheet as well. We've only, mostly only had one side, but we've got some notices because there's so many, they're going on the back. So please read the back of your sheet as well. And that is that sadly, Brunswick Baptist Church are closing, and they're having a service of Thanksgiving on the 12th of February, after the conclusion of Colin Grimm's ministry. And give thanks to the Lord for 224 years of ministry there. It's a long time. I think as a church they've always struggled with very low numbers. I remember 30 years ago, we used to go out there and sing with them and play music for them because there were so few of them, even that long ago. So please, if you can get to that, that would be really good as well. Talitha Coombe have a job vacancy if any of you are interested in working for them. The application has been slightly extended and revised. If you'd like to know about that, there's a notice on the board at the back there about that job. Is it only ladies?
Yes.
It is. Open to ladies.
No.
I guess that's probably the case.
Please.
Yes, open to ladies only, I'm afraid, that job. But the notice is on the board there. So if you're interested in that, please have a look at that. And if you wanted more questions, ask Judith. I'm sure Judith would be more than happy to answer any questions you've got on that.
Well, good morning, church. How are you this fine end of January? On the way to a new next month, we've moved into a new year. Only 29 days ago, now we've moved into a new month. So hopefully, this year, 2022, will be better than 2021. And we'll be enjoying more time together as a church, more fellowship, and growth with the Lord Jesus Christ, both in terms of our spiritual growth and our physical growth here in Witten. We're going to read now from Psalm 103. Psalm 103. This is taken from the New Living Translation. Psalm 103, verse 1. It says here, "Let all that I am praise the Lord. With my whole heart I will praise his name. Let all that I am praise the Lord. May I never forget the good things he does for me. He forgives all my sins and heals all my diseases. He redeems me from death and crowns me with love and tender mercy. He fills my life with beauty. My youth is resumed. Night is evening." He says, let all that I am, all that I am, I wonder if you're able this morning to come into the presence of God, not to give a part of you, to give a bit of you, to give a fraction of who you are, but to give all that you are to praise your God. Because he's not a God that gives us tinsy bits. He doesn't hold back. He gives us all that he can give us. And all that I am, praise the Lord. And even if you don't feel that you are renewed like the youth, maybe in a body that's getting older and frailer and is less able to celebrate spiritually, you can soar. Spiritually, you can launch yourselves up into clear azure blue skies that we have around us. You can soar above the clouds of your circumstances because you are the person of faith and because your God is there. He's not just there, he is there for you. Let's stand and worship God by singing together 1, 2, 2, 1. Praise his right.
Father, to evaporate fear in your presence. You
thank you for each other. We thank you, Lord, that we bring the Holy Spirit in each other's lives. But Lord, we long to have more of you, more of your presence, more of your more faith and resilience in our lives, because we are connected with you. Father, we live in times that are very uncertain, times that have been very fearful the last couple of years, times, Father, that have thrown changes in front of us and changed the way we live. And Father, have made us realize how much we need each other, but especially how much we need you. And we recognize, Father, in this world, Satan's doing a job. He's trying to overwhelm people right there. He's trying to swamp their books, to sink them. And Lord, we just ask you, Lord, just to give us the air of your Spirit in our lives, that we may have faith not to look down, not to look at the storm and the sea like Peter did, but to look into your eyes, Lord Jesus, and to hear that word, you can do this. You can walk. You can even walk upon a soluble substance like water. You can do this because I'm saying you can do this. And have the faith, Father, to step out of the boat of our lives and to walk looking at you and do the impossible, not to be magicians, but to celebrate and to demonstrate faith works in 2022. And to demonstrate, Father God, that you are the living God and your Son Jesus is alive, and not just alive, he is victorious. He sits at the right hand of the Father, interceding for each one of us. As we slept over the last few hours, Lord Jesus, you were praying for us. You were speaking about us to your Father God. You were looking into our lives and you were speaking to your Father, asking your Father's blessing and praying for the situations of our lives. That's the kind of God that you are. That's the kind of God we come to worship this morning. We thank you, Father God, you will do immeasurably more than we can even ask or imagine in our lives. But sometimes, Lord, it's difficult. This time of year, especially when it's cold, we don't want to go out the door. Perhaps we don't even want to get from London to do that. And the Father is hard. It can be tough, especially, Lord, when we're experiencing illness and disease, especially when we go through difficult and dark times. But Lord, you are there. You are a God for us and for your people. You are a God who wants to see the best in our lives, the best in our communities. You are a God of goodness. You are a God of grace. And not only are you a God of grace, you define grace. If you want to see grace, don't need to look in the Cambridge Dictionary or the Oxford Dictionary. You need to look at Jesus. He defines grace and love, sacrifice and truth. Help us, Lord, to see that as we gather in this place on this Sunday morning. Be with us now by your Spirit. Bless those, Lord, who due to age or difficulty with health are unable to be here. And Lord, when they watch this online later on, perhaps, we ask you, Lord, to speak into their lives too. Be with them. May they feel as if they're happy with us and know the sense of your presence. The Holy Spirit may bless them and build them, strengthen them. So, Lord, bless this time. We gather here, Lord Jesus, in your holy name, to your glory. Amen. And I go back to Carl now, asking Carol, please, with Jesus being the center. Jesus, be the center.
Jesus, be the center. passing by the crowds of people, and the priests sing your praise. I hunger and thirst for your righteousness, but it's only found one place to take me.
Rest in your grace, we are blessed by the Lord.
miracle we can come into your presence. You are a holy God. We are an unholy people in ourselves. Left our own devices, we don't come even close to holy. Holy in the sense of falling apart, perhaps. Holy in the sense that there's lots of gaps in our goodness and our perfection. Holy only in the sense that we're not complete. Father God, Jesus makes us complete. We suddenly have a holiness, a wholeness, an integrity that's not ours. And so, Father God, all the glory, all the glory, all the praise, all the thanks goes to you. We don't obtain a simple peace because, Father, we haven't done it. You have. Lord Jesus, you allowed yourself to be nailed to a tree for us. You said, it is finished. Ended the tyranny of sin in the life of mankind. You're the one who said, forgive them. And we know not what they do. You're the one who brings life through death. An eternal life through your resurrection. There's that hope, Father. That hope, Lord Jesus, that we have today as we come into this place. We are the resurrection people. We know that no matter what darkness this world throws at us, but in the end, we will come out victorious because you, Lord Jesus, are victorious. We're on the way not to an end as such, but a beginning that began the time that you came out to. But Lord, when you said it is finished, it wasn't just, it is finished to sin, to the power of sin. You were saying, Lord Jesus, it is finished to the power of death and the fear that death has had over mankind for millennia. And Lord, we pray that you may just help us, each and every one, to grasp hold of that truth through faith. In a world full of fake news and fake hope and fake security, Lord, we know that you are true. And we ask you, Lord Jesus, that you may breathe that faith and that belief into our lives. That we may walk down the streets here in Winton or in Ipswich or elsewhere in the country with our head held high because we know the Lord of Lords and the King of Kings. Because we are his servants. We are followers of Jesus. We are proud to know him. Proud to be part of your family. Because of what you've done for us. Not what we've done for ourselves, but what you've done for us. Help us, Lord. Give us that joy and that strength that comes from finding our joy in you. Lord, we want to pray for the world in which we live. Lord, it's in a pretty rubbish state by now, as you know. We want to pray especially, Father, for the building up of power on the edges of Ukraine and Crimea. And Father, we pray that you may bring an end to that madness. We pray you, Father, you may bring a real diplomatic solution that whatever's behind the madness in Putin's mind, we ask you, Father God, to remove it, to bring sanity and wisdom into his decisions. And we pray, Father, that may not escalate and may not result in another invasion, another suppression, yet more darkness. We pray for the people of Ukraine. We pray for their safety and their security. We pray for all the governments around the world, good and evil, that are working to bring about a peaceful solution. Father God, bless us. We pray, Father, for those who are worried because of the storms that have recently battered Northern Ireland, and Northern England, and Scotland. And we pray, God, for the families of the 9-year-old boy and the old woman in Scotland, dear Father. We pray, Lord, that this day, as they wake up, you may surround them with your peace and your presence. Be with them, Lord. You remember the people of Tonga. We pray for them, Father, as they clear up after the volcanic explosion. And we pray you may be with the families who lost loved ones as they begin to clear up and try and rebuild homes and businesses and lives. Father, be in that place. We thank you, Lord, that there's so many people around you in Tonga who genuinely know you. We thank you for that. And we pray that you may sustain them in this dark hour and give them peace. We pray for ourselves, Father, as people in this fellowship who are going through difficult times, are struggling with health issues. Some are unable to be here on Sunday because they're shielded at home. People who are suffering the effects of lost loved ones in the last 18 months or so. We just pray, Lord, for all those who need our prayers. hands. You know they are above. We lift them before you. We thank you, Lord Jesus. You are praying for them even as we speak. You are the great intercessor of the souls. Bring peace. Bring healing. Bring help. Thank you. Bless us this day, Father. May we as a congregation here grow in size, but also grow in faith. And Lord Jesus, may build us up to realize that with God, nothing is impossible. But you are the God that removes him from impossible. You are a God who made us, and made us out of nothing. Lord, nothing stands in your way. You can make creation out of nothing. What can you not do? Nothing. So Lord, we thank you. You have a God who's great, who's mighty, and giving thanks. Be with us now, Lord, as we look at your word. Speak to our hearts, build us up, and bring us closer to you. Because we ask these prayers in Jesus' name. We're going to sing the next song, it's number 418. Lift up your heads. We'll have the offering to lift up your heads.
Ephesians chapter 2, Ephesians chapter 2, reading from verse 1 to 10. We'll continue our series looking at the slogans of the Reformation. And the reason these are so important is because the Reformation changed the whole of Europe and the Western world, the thinking of Europe and the Western world. And there are five main key slogans, five motifs, if you like, that were used, that were critical and sum up not only what changed not only sum up the Reformation, but actually sum up the Christian faith. They're critical, five critical truths about how we are as Christians, about our faith. And today we're looking at one called sola gratia, which means by grace alone. So Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 to 10, I'm reading from the New International Version. As for you, when you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient, all of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh and following its desires and faults. Like the rest, we were by nature deserving of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And when God raised us up with Christ and seated us in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace, expressing his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace you have been saved, through faith. And this is not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. May God bless to us that reading of his holy word. Many years ago in New England, in America, a young burglar happened upon an old house with its back door unlocked. So under the cover of darkness, he snuck inside and began to rummage around the house while his occupants slept upstairs. He quietly opened drawers. He looked through cupboards and searched for money and anything he could sell quickly for cash. Suddenly, he heard behind him a board creak. And swinging around, he looked right into the double barrel of a rifle. At the other end of that shotgun, or those two barrows he was looking down, stood an elderly gentleman who simply smiled and said this: "Young man, I warn you now, but you are standing in the space that I'm about to shoot." And with that, the young man quickly vacated that space and also that house. And this morning we've just read from Ephesians chapter 2 and verses 1 to 10, a very famous and a very popular passage. And I need to warn you, dear people, that you are standing right now in a place at which I am about to shoot. This whole passage gets to the very core of the gospel, the very core of how we can become Christians, how we can follow Jesus Christ. And it's relevant, and it's relevant to every one of us, both you, if you in the congregation today, in Witten, those watching online. And the first thing that becomes apparent in these 10 short verses is Paul tells us this, that we are in a grave crisis. A grave crisis. And I mean that quite literally. Literally a grave crisis. Paul tells us in verse 1, "As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins." And just in case you fell asleep in that particular part of the passage, he repeats it in verse 5 by saying that God made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in transgressions. Dead in transgressions. Paul is saying, spiritually, before you become a Christian, you are dead, you are gravely ill. You are in fact in your grave. You are there. You are buried. You are dead. In terms of emergency, we often enjoy the expression, don't we? You know, when there's life, there's hope. Well, for people outside of Christ, literally, in terms of human effort, there is no hope because there is no life. This is what people struggle with sometimes. Pride gets in the way. People, human beings are proud, and that's a good thing. Okay? Pride is a good thing as long as it's kept in its rightful place. Pride destroyed an angel called Beelzebub, who became the devil, because he thought he could be as good as God. And pride destroys many people's lives because they think they can be as good as God. They think they can save themselves. They think they're good enough. What keeps people out of church is often pride. They think, "I'm okay. I'm not as bad as John Smith down the road. You know about John Smith? You don't know about..." Let me tell you about John Smith. And they're informed of all the faults of John Smith. When it comes to the faults of John Smith, the person informing on John Smith, he doesn't want you to know about it. Because pride. We're happy to point the finger at other people. We don't like it when people point the finger at us. and suggest that we could be at fault. We could be bad. We are in our graves. We are spiritually dead. That's what the Bible says. And when you're dead, there is nothing you can do. Nothing. Your brown bread, you're pushing up the daisies, your worm food, there is nothing. So what's put us there? Well, the answer in this passage is quite clear. Paul says there's a deadly disease, and it is a deadly disease, called sin. The reason we call it sin is because it's quite descriptive in the Bible what sin is. Sin is not merely making a little mistake, telling a white lie or things like that. Sin is open rebellion against God. And just to make sure that we understand this, Paul describes sin using two words. He says, you are dead in your sins and transgressions. Sins and transgressions are two different words. The thing about sin is that we've kind of neutralized it. We've renewed it, we've cut the power out of sin, because we now make sin something which is quite comical. You know, and we do this, you know, by making sin something which is about eating too much chocolate, or, you know, doing something which is just slightly wrong. You know, it's almost a good thing. It's an indulgence. That's what sin is. It's an indulgence. The Bible doesn't describe sin as an indulgence. It describes it in far more stark terms. Sin in the Bible is never being naughty. It is treason. It is treason. And in this country, and in most countries around the world, treason is punishable by one thing. Which is what? Death. You know, you don't go to someone who's committed treason against the crown, and the queen says, oh, you naughty, naughty boy. 100 lines. You're in detention. Treason is punished only by one way. It is death. In the Greek here, there's two words, and they're quite interesting, both of them. The first word, sin, is literally a word, hamartia, and hamartia is a shooting word. It's a shooting word. And it's all about, the essence of the sin here is missing the mark, missing the target. If you watch, if you enjoy watching anything like the Olympics, you know that it's all on the grade of how they hit the mark, whereabouts they've hit the target. Now, if you go hunting, you know, if you ever go hunting, missing the mark means you've missed. And the reality is, if you miss the mark, you have missed. It doesn't matter if you missed a couple of inches or by, you know, cubic mile. You've missed. You see, that's the problem with this kind of thing, is that when we talk about sin, people like to think, well, I haven't missed by much. You know, I've almost got there. I'm on the target, but I'm not quite in the bullseye. That's okay, come on. It's okay, I'm on the target, I'm not that bad. The problem is that the Bible says, you know, that we all fall short of the glory of God. It's not my glory you fall short of, the glory of Cole. It's not your glory you fall short of. It is God's glory. Where in life, do we ever have tests when we set the standards? Imagine that. You do your driving tests. I know examiner, my driving wasn't perfect. You know, I may have got down that woman on the zebra crossing, but to be honest, she should have been looking where she was going. You know, I had indicators, I was going to stop. And okay, I did go through a red light, but it was on the verge of turning from amber to red. And come on, it wasn't that bad a drive. I mean, after all, I didn't kill anyone. Where do you go to test when you define the area of the test? University. Yes, Professor, I know I didn't read any books, and I know I didn't do my essays, and I didn't complete the exams, at least not very well, but I was there in the class. Every time you lectured, I was there. Please, you've got to give me the university degree, because I was there. In what walk of life do we ever do that? Do we define the test? And when people come to salvation, people say, come on, God, I'm good enough. I'm good enough for me. That must be good enough for you. We all fall short of the glory of God. The fact is, we may have only missed the target by a little bit, but we've missed the target, and that is still a fail. That's what sin means. It's a shooting word. It's about hitting the target. The other word he uses is trespasses. And trespasses is a paratoma, is a walking word. It's talking about how you walk. And when you trespass, you're walking in the wrong area. When you're trespassing, you're walking in an area you shouldn't be. Trespass is talking about slipping and falling. It's about getting lost. That's what that word is all about. It's a walking word. And basically, people who believe they're good enough for God are saying, I've never missed the mark. I've always hit the target 100%. They're saying, I've never fallen. I've never slipped. I've never gone down the wrong path. I've never gone the wrong way. And we all know that's fake news. That's the biggest fake news out there, isn't it? Even if we try and convince ourselves that's true, we know it's not. We all fall short of the glory of God. You know the great key of that is that inside you, when God made you, he gave you a little indicator when you go right and wrong. A little compass inside you. Not only points you to God in terms of relationship, it points you to where morality is. It's called your conscience. It's in there. God put it in there for a reason. To help us and to guide us. And no matter what we say and how we live our lives, deep down in the back of our mind, often that conscience is saying, oh, no. You know, you should be going that way and you're going that way. Don't try and kid yourself. The fact is, we've all fallen short of the glory of God. Psalm 14 verse 1 says, they are corrupt, their deeds are vile. There is no one who does good. And then in verse 3 of Psalm 14 it says, all have turned away and have become corrupt. There is no one who does good, not even one. The problem with that word corrupt is that people often think when preachers like me are saying you're corrupt, I'm saying you're the worst of the worst. I'm not saying that. Some of the hardest people to bring into the kingdom of God are good people. Because they're convinced they're so good, but they don't need to repent. They don't need the salvation of God. They are good enough. You know, it's easier to bring into the kingdom of God a murderer and someone who's gone to prison because they're aware of their fallenness. There's so many of us so-called good people. We don't like to think of ourselves being, well, that person. Because we're not that person. We're me. I'm okay. And there's other pressures on people in the world today and pressures on you. Because we're told in verse 10 that there are the ways of this world, in verse 2. Literally, the ways of this world, it uses the word eon, you've probably heard of, which means age. The age of this world, it refers to cultural pressures. Every age has cultural pressures put upon people to go a certain way, to do a certain thing. Fashions, we can call them. Peer pressures, if you like. And this can be extreme, and we look through the ages, and we can see there can be good pressures and bad cultural pressures. When I was last stationed in Germany, I was the warden of Church House Germany, which was a Christian conference centre up in the Lübecker Hills, around about 60 beds. And most of my staff were German. One of my jobs was to teach military ethics to soldiers. And I used to take soldiers to an infamous castle. You may not have heard of this castle. It's an infamous castle. It's Wiebelsburg Castle. I used to take them down there and teach them. And it was the spiritual home of the SS. And Himmler was quite mad. He really was quite mad. One of his great advisors, who made a colonel in the SS, was a man who'd been convicted by a certain court and sent to prison because he was deranged, quite literally, by Austria. And when they discovered this, that he was the spiritual advisor to Himmler, they had to cover it up because they can't have the National Socialist Party, the Nazi Party, having Himmler been advised by a man who'd been declared criminally insane. But Himmler loved his castle because it's very unusual. It's actually based on a triangle. And Himmler was big into the occult. And the big tower, which you can't see behind this tower here, the big round tower there, at the bottom of it, it's got a special, it was built specially so the sound resounds around it. And there was the eternal flame. It's the SS. That's what the SS soldiers used to get given their SS death heads rings. So I used to go and take soldiers down there and talk about it. But the most stark, sad thing about this castle was that it was refurbished by slave labour. And this castle sits right in the middle of the village of Wiebelsburg. And there was a concentration camp right in the middle of this village. And the people who actually, most of them were devout Catholics, because a lot of people in the southern part of Germany actually were very devout in their faith. They knew that these people were being worked to death. Farmers have written about it after the war, saying that when they were actually out farming their fields, there could often be a sickly smell coming out from the crematoria, coming across the fields. Well, what did the German Christians do? And this wasn't all German Christians, because there were some really fine German Christians. But a lot of German Christians who treated their faith lightly, they did this. They joined the German Christian movement, Deutsche Christen. They became part of the German Christian movement. And the German Christian movement took the prevalent culture of the time, and it took the swastika, and where did they put it? Right in the centre of the cross. And these Christians would argue and argue that this is the right way. This is the way you're going to reach the German people by actually, and it did. There's many people in the Nazi party and many people in the SS who believe they were devout Christians because they were part of the Deutsche Christen. Because they bled to believe a lie. Because the church was not doing what it should have done. And the real church in Germany became the confessing church. And was led by men like Martin Niemöller and Dietrich Bonhoeffer. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who was killed 2 weeks by the end of the World War by having his head cut off, executed by the Nazis. Brave, brave people in Germany who were fighting the gospel, but they had to do it undercover. Because the church generally had assimilated the culture and not stood up against it. What do we do? There's a lady, I read an article, account of a lady, a Christian lady in the South, who wrote of her shame because they had a railway line behind the church. And occasionally when trains took people off to the concentration camps behind the church, they could hear the screams and the shouts of the people. So what did they do? What did they do? They sang louder to drown out the cries. We as the Christian church have to stand up for truth because there is a power in this age, a power in this world that's trying to silence Christianity, that's trying to get rid of the heart of the gospel of Jesus Christ, that tries to say there's no truth but your truth and my truth. And many Christians died in Germany for their Lord Jesus Christ. There's many, many stories you can read about them of Christians who did incredible things but came into conflict while the general church simply embraced something that was wrong and was evil. You see, this present age is not under the rule of God. And if we embrace this present age, we are not embracing God, we are embracing Satan. Paul tells us this. And the word Satan, Satanos in Greek language, means one thing. It means enemy. And if you embrace the enemy, you are going to be pulled down by him because he is a destroyer. He's got nothing but evil intended for your life. And Paul describes this in verse 2. He talks about him as the ruler of the kingdom of the air. He says, he talks about before being a Christian, when you follow the ways of this world, that's the eons of passions, when you follow the passions of this world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. There is a spiritual force in this world that isn't godly, that isn't right, that's demonic. We don't like to think about this because we like to think of comfy things. But it's a reality. It's not the exorcist, that kind of rubbish you see on TV and the horror films. It's just that's all just a nonsense. But there's a spiritual power in this world that fights against the truth and wants to drag people down. And we as Christians have been praying against that and fighting against it. Because it's not going to last. Jesus defeated this spiritual power on the cross. But we're on our way right now to Berlin, as I said last week. The victory is secure, but we're not yet there. Hitler's still alive. We've got to go and take the victory. The material world is not under the rule of God in that sense. It's under the rule of Satan. But Jesus is coming soon, and we've got to make sure that our message can be heard, and we don't subdue it to the current culture and the trends and the fashions of this world. We are to be transformed by the renewing of our minds by Jesus Christ, not the renewing of our minds by our culture and by our society. There are dark forces at play. Paul mentions this again in Galatians 4 and verse 3. Galatians 4 verse 3 says this, when we were children, we were slaves to the elemental spirits of the universe. That's what Paul says. Galatians 4:3. We were slaves to the elemental spirits of the universe. There are dark forces at play in our world. He mentions exactly the same in Colossians 2, verse 8. See to it that no one takes you captive through hollow and deceptive philosophy, which depend on human tradition and the elemental spiritual forces of this world, rather than on Christ. Christians, the only way you can fight an enemy is when you recognize an enemy. 25 years I was in the military, I know that to be true. If you don't believe the enemy is there, the enemy will grow and progress, and he will simply get victory because you've ignored him. There are dark forces at work in our world, and we need to be praying against them and praying for the light of Christ to shine in the world in which we live. And these dark forces will seek to pull us away from God, elevate our pride. You know, you look at Adam and Eve in a great example of temptation. Elevates the pride of someone. Why are you being denied this? You deserve this. A bit like a Nivea advert, you know, because you're worth it. Take the apple, you're worth it, Eve. How dare God deny you that? Why can't you have that? You are good enough, you are worth it. Take it, it's yours. And the pride of Eve and Adam bring about the fallenness of our society and our lives. And in reality, because Satan's a lie, he describes God as removing and denying you things. But God is a God of great love. This is what Paul says here constantly. Verse 4, because of God's love for us. We are cut off from God. We are in our graves. We are dead in our sins and our transgressions. Isaiah 59 verse 2 says, your iniquities have separated you from God. Your sins have hidden his face from you so that he will not fear. So he will not hear. Again, Colossians 2 verse 13. You were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your flesh. We can't save ourselves. We can't do it. No matter how we try. To quote a famous character, I haven't got any sound of it coming through. Fraser, what does he say? We're doomed! We're doomed! We're doomed. Well, we are. Except there is a way, there's a truth, and there's a life. And Paul takes us straight into that. He talks here about a godly characteristic. A godly characteristic. If left to us, there will be no hope because we're dead in our sins. But there is hope. And a great German theologian, Martin Luther, who was a professor in systematics, and particularly in the theology of Paul, was reading Romans, studying Romans in the original language. And it was as he read Romans, the book of Romans, his faith began to grow. Martin Luther is an incredible guy. He was someone who struggled greatly with his overwhelming sense of sin and failing. That's why he became a monk. He became a monk because he was in the middle of a storm. He was going to be working on it, following his father in his father's trade, and he was going across a field, and there was a lightning storm, and he was so terrified of the lightning storm, he said, God, if you save me and preserve me, I'll become a monk. And that's what happened. At the age of 17, Martin Luther went off, much to his father's annoyance, and became a monk. And he spent most of his life trying to find a way of getting rid of that sense of failure inside his life, that conscience. He wrote this, he said, I tried as hard as I could to keep the rule, that's the monastic rule. I used to be contrite and make a list of my sins. I confessed them again and again. I scrupulously carried out the penances which were allotted to me. Yet my conscience kept on nagging. It kept telling me, you fell short there. You're not sorry enough. You left that sin off your list. I was trying to cure the doubts and the scruples of my conscience with human remedies, but traditions of men. The more I tried these remedies, the more troubled and uneasy my conscience grew. He had the overwhelming sense of the majesty of God and the sinfulness of man. And eventually Martin Luther, as he began to read the book of Romans and read it in the original language, he suddenly realized something. He was right. He couldn't be good enough. He would never be good enough. But God was good enough. And that changed his focus. He realized that God had done it all for him. Verse 4 and 5 of this passage, Paul says, but because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ even when we were dead in sin and transgressions. God is not just have mercy. He is rich in mercy. He overflows with mercy. He doesn't have a little bit of mercy. He has loads of mercy for people. He has great love for us, says Paul. He doesn't just have a little bit of love for us. He has a great love for us. It is a godly characteristic that brings us to become Christians. See, the key is this, is don't look at yourself. Don't look in the mirror and think, there I'm going to find my salvation. If you look in the mirror, all you're going to do is look in the area that caused the problem in the first place. You need to look to Jesus. Look beyond ourselves. Look to the one who's rich in mercy. Look to the one in verse 5 who made us alive. How do we become alive in Christ? We don't make ourselves alive. When you're dead, you're dead. You can't give yourself the kiss of life because you have no life. We are made alive in Christ. He is the mechanism of our salvation. He is the one that gives us the kiss of life and breathes into us. Colossians 2, Paul says, when you were dead in your sins and transgressions and the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive with Christ. And so one day as Martin Luther sat in his little tower, he sat at the tower, he was studying in the tower in Wittenberg, suddenly the penny dropped and he realized it was by grace. And Martin Luther was transformed, and God began a reformation in his life that caused a reformation in Europe. You know, this resonates with me, and I know I said this last week, a wee bit about myself. That's not me, that's Martin Luther, obviously. Didn't have very good razors in those days, always. He was before his time in fashion. Fashion was stubble. But back in Germany, serving there as a young policeman, Royal Air Force policeman, many, many years ago, I had that same struggle as Martin Luther. I knew I wasn't good enough. And I spent hours, I said to you last week, hours in the station church on my knees praying. I used to try and earn forgiveness from God. And as a young man, you know, I was fighting my thought patterns all the time and, you know, and things, all the temptations that young men experience. And I would try and atone for my sins by doing things. So I used to give things away. Give loads of things away. I remember going to the nappy and buying myself, I needed socks. Bought myself 6 pairs of socks. Got them in a sale in the nappy in Germany, in Irish Robert. When I felt guilty, I bought too many socks. Satan began to condemn me. I bought too many socks. So I went around all my Christian friends in the block and began to say, do you need some socks? When one of my mates said, yeah, I need some socks, I felt God has spoken to me to give you these 3 pairs of socks. And I gave them away. I did that all the time. I got rid of all my nice things. I used to have a donkey jacket. I've still got it. It's in the garage. A donkey jacket. That was my main coat. You know, cheap donkey jacket for millets, about 15 quid. Or in those days, probably about £7.50. I don't know how much it was. Not very much. I had a very cheap bag. I used to carry things. I gave away anything that was any value to myself. I gave it away. When I left the Royal Air Force, all the savings I had, I gave them away. Because I was trying to earn my salvation. And I had no peace. Until one day, when I was at Bible college, and I began to understand, and I had a great teacher called Dr. Roy Kersley, I began to understand it's by faith you are saved. And that is a gift of God. Not of yourself, so no one can boast. And so finally we come in this wonderful passage to this, a graceful conclusion. A graceful conclusion. For it is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not of yourselves. It is a gift of God. You know, pride can be the thing that keeps us away from God. Accepting that you're not good enough is what we need. To confess and to come before God and say, look, Lord, I need your help. Save me. Faith is at the center of our salvation. And that faith is given to us by God. It is by grace we have been saved. Just to make sure that we understand this, Paul doesn't mention this once in 10 verses. He mentions it twice. Verse 5 and verse 8. That we've been made alive with Christ, even with dead in transgressions, it is by grace you have been saved. Both 5 and 8 say that. And why is that? So in verse 9 he tells us, not by works, so no one can boast. It's the gift of God. You know what's very insulting for God? If God gives you a gift of salvation and you want to pay for it? Would you ever do that to a friend? Your birthday? Hey, John, here's a present for you. That's great. How much do I owe you? Wouldn't your friend be insulted by that? Wouldn't they be upset? Wouldn't they say, this is a gift. This is for meeting you. I'm showing my love. And yet we do that to God. God gives us salvation and we say, how much do I owe you, God? How much more do I need to do? How much more do I need to give? How much more of my time? And we're saying to God, we want to pay for it. We want to be self-made Christians. But we can't be self-made Christians. Proud Christians do not allow, you don't see grace in proud Christians. We need grace in our lives. Because it's a gift of God, so no one can boast. I have a boast. And you have a boast. And our boast is in Jesus Christ. He is the one we boast in. He is the one we celebrate. He is the one we sing about. Not me, not you. A gift is something that we receive. And there's a reason for this. There's a wonderful reason. And you find it in the very end of that passage. Right in the end of the passage. It just kind of sticks in there. Verse 10. Paul says, for we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. You know, I like the New International Version, but sometimes Bible versions don't always translate the best. And the word handiwork is masterpiece. You know, people go around the world into the capitals of the world and they visit the masterpieces of the artists, don't they? They love to go in. Pure and I went on her birthday last year. We went down to St. Paul's Cathedral, went to celebrate, went on the eye. One of the things we went to do was I wanted to see in St. Paul's Cathedral the famous picture by Holman Hunt, Jesus, the Light of the World. We're looking forward to it. And then we discovered that actually they're doing refurbishment works in St. Paul's Cathedral, and that particular part where the picture is out of limits. So it wasn't particularly good, but we wanted to see a masterpiece, this famous picture of Jesus outside someone's life and knocking on the door. But God intends for you to be a masterpiece. He intends for you to be something beautiful, you to be something wonderful that other people can see and don't see you, they see God and they wonder and they're amazed by this wonderful masterpiece of grace. And it's going to bomb in 1987. A small town in Northern Ireland, west of Belfast, it had an IRA bomb planted. It was planted to go off on Remembrance Sunday, on the 8th of November. It was time to detonate right at the time that everyone was gathered together around the cenotaph in the centre of the village. 11 people were killed. In fact, 12 people were killed because one person died 11 years later. He was in a coma for 11 years before he died. So 12 people died. And 63 people were seriously injured in that bombing. And Gordon Wilson was a man who sadly lost this girl called Marie Wilson. And she was 20 years old, training to be a nurse at the time. And she was buried under 5 feet of concrete and brick. And her injured father, who was badly injured, sat with her holding her hand. And her last words were this: Daddy, I love you very much. She suffered severe spinal injury and brain injuries, and she died later on in hospital. You know, when we think of Ennis Gillan, we think of the horror of that bombing, indiscriminate killing of people, and the cynical way it was done in the middle of a remembrance service. But also what we remember of that, and certainly what I remember of that, is not just that event, but it's the words of this man, Gordon Wilson, about his daughter. Because later on, the media came around and they interviewed him in his bed in hospital, expecting to get the usual tirade of anger and aggression against the perpetrators of his evil crime. And yet instead, they heard this. He said to the media, he said, I've lost my daughter. But I bear no grudge. Bitter talk will not bring Mary Wilson back to life. I shall pray tonight and every night that God will forgive them. And that man, Gordon Wilson, became part of the peace movement in Northern Ireland and worked for the rest of his life in a mission to reconcile Protestants and Catholics in that province. That is grace. Gordon Wilson became a masterpiece. A beautiful picture of love and grace That when we think about Enniskillen, we think more about the words of Gordon Wilson than we do about the horror and the wickedness of those men who carried out that act. And grace is undeserved. Grace is unearned, and it's beautiful. And God gives you his grace through Christ Jesus, so that you might too become a masterpiece, something beautiful. He gives us the gift of life. If you could boast about it, you would become a nice person. Remember school, the boasty boy, the boasty girl? They're nice people. They're the kind of people you want to befriend, the kind of person who says, look at me, look what I've done. They're not, are they? Often the people we love are the people who are humble and self-effacing. The people who ask more about you than tell about themselves. Verse 10, for we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared us in advance to do. God has prepared a picture for you, a masterpiece for you to be, if only you allow his grace to surface in your life. You see, we are works of grace. Think about it. Is there someone you need to forgive? Someone you need to go and see and say, I forgive you for that. Whatever it is. Is there someone who's longing to receive grace from us? Member of our family? Member of our street or community? How can you show grace at work this week? How can you show grace to those around you? Is there someone who needs to see Christ's grace and forgiveness in you? You know, we don't work to be saved, but God saves us, so we will work. Work to become graceful people. You become a masterpiece of his love and his compassion. Paul writes in Romans 6 these words. He says, offer yourselves to God as those who have been brought back from death to life. That's our mission. Become a masterpiece for Jesus and bring grace into this world. Amen. Let's stand and sing our final song. It's Here Is Love, Vast as the Ocean. Vessels of grace. People who others can see have been transformed, but there's something magical about them. And we can say that you are the one who brings that magic. You are the one who brings forgiveness. You are the one who brings purpose and peace. You are the one who brings grace through Christ Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Amen.